I welcome you to our Bible study tonight. And I pray that this new series of studies will be a blessing to your heart and will empower you for everything the Lord has for you for the rest of your life and ministry in Jesus' name. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come to you and we bless your name. Thank you, Lord, for giving us the revelation of your mind and the truth of your word that will help us in our journey from here towards eternity. We're asking, Lord, as we begin this new series today, you will enlighten us and enrich our lives with your word in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're coming to the study of the epistle of Paul to the Corinthians, the first epistle. And tonight, as we begin in the introductory study, we're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, reading from verse 1 through to verse 9. In verse 1, Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God, and Sosthenes, our brother. And then in verse 2, it says, unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, both theirs and ours. And then in verse 3, grace be unto you, and peace from God our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God which is given you by Jesus Christ, that in everything ye are enriched by him, in all utterance and in all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that ye come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom we were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Tonight, those are the verses we are studying, and the topic is Christ's purposeful call into his kingdom. As you think about Paul the Apostle, the writer, he was called into the kingdom of God. As you think about the Christians in Corinth, they were called into the kingdom of God, and they were called for a purpose. Whether an apostle, or a pastor, or a minister, or the steward of the glorious mysteries of Christ, were all called with a purpose. And it's not only the Corinthian believers that were called. You are called, I am called into the kingdom. As we turn away from our sin and turn to the Savior and turn to the Lord, we receive that call, the call to salvation. And being saved, we come to the kingdom of God. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So our calling then to salvation is the call to the kingdom of God. And he wants to tell us the purpose of that call, the reason for that call, and the responsibility we have in Christ as we respond to the call of the Lord Jesus Christ. Once again, the topic is Christ's purposeful call into his kingdom. Three things we're looking at. Number one, the call and the consecration of Christ's servant. That's talking about Paul the Apostle. The Lord called him. He responded to that call. He committed himself to the Lord, and he consecrated himself, his service, everything he had, to the call of God and to the commission. The Lord had given him the call and the consecration of Christ's servant. Number two is the congregation of converted souls, the people that were converted, the people that responded to the message of the gospel. Through the Apostle Paul, they were converted. Now we see that congregation and we see the confirmation too. Point number two is the congregation and the confirmation of converted souls. Point number three, the confirmation of the charismata. The charismata is the gifts, spiritual gifts on consecrated saints. Those saints consecrated themselves when they first came to the Lord. They committed themselves when they first came to the Lord. And because of that consecration commitment, the Lord conferred upon them, endowed them, endued them with the gifts of the Spirit. The confirmation of the charismata on consecrated saints. We're coming to Paul the writer. That is point number one. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 1. The call and the consecration of Christ's servant. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, what a name. Paul, what a minister. Paul, what an apostle. Here is one who had been opposed to the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. He was opposed to the church of the living God. And then you know his story. The Lord met him on the way. And the Lord questioned him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. It is hard for you to kick against the pricks. Immediately then he surrendered himself. He said, Lord, what will you have me to do? And the Lord told him to go to Damascus where he was going, but then he was not going to be a persecutor now. The Lord had called him. That's Paul, and then he responded to that call, and when he responded to that call, a change came. In fact, Ananias said, Brother Saul, the Lord who appeared to you on your way to Damascus has sent me unto you, that your eyes will be opened physically, your eyes will be opened spiritually, and you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And you know his story. That's the Paul that is writing this epistle to the Corinthian believers. He says, Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ. He knew the calling he had. He knew the commission he had. He knew what his life was now to be from now on until the very end. He said, I have a calling. I have a commission, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God. He said, this is the will of God. I'm at the center of the will of God as I pursue and as I progress in the calling that God had given me, Paul the Apostle said, as an apostle. It's through the will of God, and then he brings in a companion in ministry now and sustains our brother. We're looking at Paul, and to understand him, we're going to look at various areas of his life, his spiritual life, his ministerial life, everything about him as he surrendered to this call of God and the consecration he manifested. Why are we looking at that? We're looking at that so that we'll see the example. We'll see the format. We'll see the pattern of the life of Paul the Apostle, the ministry of Paul the Apostle. And then we ourselves will be able to surrender like he did. Paul is gone. We are the people here now. In the same way that God called Paul the Apostle, he has called us too. We are called into the kingdom of God for a purpose, for a reason, and it is through the will of God. And let's look at seven things about his life. Number one is conversion by the seeking Savior. The seeking Savior. The Lord Jesus Christ was the one that sought him out. Actually, Jesus had said he came so that he would seek and save those who were lost. Paul, as Saul, was lost, and the Lord was seeking him. And when he was there in heaven, he sought him, and he came and spoke to him. He called his name. It was the Lord Jesus Christ that sought him out. His conversion after that seeking Savior called him and then arrested him and brought him to conviction, and he turned around. He wanted to observe, he wanted to do the will of Christ who called him. Now look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 9. I'm reading from verse 3. Acts chapter 9, we're looking at verse 3. It says, and it's as he journeyed, that is Saul, as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And then in verse 4 it says, and he fell to the earth when that light shone around him, and he heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And then he responded in verse 5, he said, and he said, who art thou, Lord? He knew the voice was coming from heaven, and there's no one, not a human being there that will be calling him from heaven. He knew this must be the Lord, but he wanted to know, who are you, Lord? Are you God Almighty? Are you the Son of God? Are you Jesus Christ? Who are you? Who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus. Hold on there. Jesus is Lord. Who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus. You remember, he died for our sins. You remember, he was buried. And you remember, he rose again. And he is Lord of all. The Lord of the people that now accept him. And the Lord of the whole universe eventually. And the Lord said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And now in verse 6, here is the surrender of this man that brought his conversion. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, he still called him Lord. Understand, from the very beginning, he began to say, Lord, Lord, Lord. And you remember that if you will receive the Lord Jesus Christ from your heart, and if you will believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, thou shalt be saved. Here is how salvation came to him. Here is how conversion came to him. He said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do. What thou must do. And then we're told in verse 7, it says in verse 7, and the men who journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice and seeing no man. In verse 8, it tells us, it says, and Saul arose from the earth, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no man, but they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. Now it tells us in verse 9, when he got to Damascus, what was he doing? When he got to Damascus, was he roaming about visiting this and visiting that? Look at what he was doing. And it was 3 days without sight. Neither did he eat nor drink. He was without sight. All he was doing now was praying. And look at verse 15 here. In verse 15 it says, but the Lord said unto Ananias, unto him, go thy way. For he is a chosen vessel unto me. Paul the apostle now, Paul the new convert now, the Lord said, he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. Look at verse 16. In verse 16, the Lord said, for I will show him, I will show Paul the apostle, I will show that Saul that just gave himself fully to the Lord now, I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. Verse 17 says, and Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hands on him said, brother Saul, understand that, born again already, brother Saul, called into salvation, brother Saul, called into the kingdom. He was now born again, a child of God, a member of the family of God, brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus. There's no doubt in your mind now, the Lord is Jesus. Jesus is the Lord. The Lord, even Jesus, that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest. has sent me that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And be filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, we see that as the Lord sought him, he responded. In fact, he says in Galatians chapter 1, verses 15 and 16, he said, when the Lord who brought me out of my mother's womb, when he called me by his grace, he said, I conferred not with flesh and blood. He responded promptly. That's how we're to respond to the Lord. He responded immediately. That's how we're to respond to the Lord. He responded with all his heart, with all his soul, and that's how we're to respond to you. That brought his conversion. His conversion by the seeking Savior. Number two now is call to soul-saving service. Is call to soul-saving service. The Lord had called him, and the call was to save souls. The call was to bring the gospel, the message of life, and the message of salvation, the message of the grace of God unto the sinners that had not known the Lord. Look at Acts chapter 26. We're looking at verse 16. Acts chapter 26, verse 16. He was now recounting. He was now retelling. He was now testifying of what had happened when the Lord called him. It says in Acts chapter 26, verse 16, but rise, this is what the Lord said unto him, and stand on thy feet, for I, the Lord, have appeared unto thee for this purpose, for this reason, to make thee a minister and a witness both of these things which thou hast seen, and of those things in the which I will appear unto thee. What was he to do? What was the call all about? Look at verse 17. Delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles, unto whom now I send thee. In verse 18, here is a soul-saving service. It was to carry out, to open their eyes, to turn them from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins. That's salvation. That's the purpose you are going out. That's the purpose you are reaching out. That's the purpose of my calling upon you. That they, the people you are going to reach, the Gentiles, the Israelites, the Jews, everyone you confront with the gospel of the grace of God, it is so that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Number three, let's look at his concern for sinners' salvation. Immediately the Lord called him. Here was his concern for Jews and for Gentiles. It says in Romans chapter 9, verse 1. Romans chapter 9, verse 1. It says, I, Paul the apostle, I, the one that is called and responded, I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost. What's the Holy Ghost bearing witness for in his heart? It says that I, Paul, have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. In verse 3, it says, for I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ. For my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. It tells us it pursues this concern in chapter 10, reading from verse 1. Romans chapter 10, looking at verse 1. The concern he had for the people, sinners, that were not saved, whether they were Jews or Gentiles, all sinners everywhere that he could come across. Here was the concern that he had for their salvation. It says, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. That's the concern we ought to have too. That's the concern you ought to have too. That the people who are near, the people who are your kindreds, the people who are of your tribe, the people who are of the same language, the same country as you are, that they might be saved. And the people who are not of the same tribe, who are not of the same nation, that they might be saved too. It tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, First Corinthians chapter 9, we're looking at verse 16. It says in verse 16 of First Corinthians chapter 9, "For though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of, for necessity is laid upon me. Yea, woe is me, woe is unto me, if I preach not the gospel." It tells us in verse, reading from verse 19 there, in verse 19, it says, "For though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant unto all, whether they're Jews or they're Gentiles, whether they're young or they're old, whoever they are, men or women, I make myself servant unto all, that I might gain them all." That was his concern. In verse 20, it says, in verse 20, "And unto the Jews I became as a Jew, that I might gain the Jews. To them that are under the law," still talking about the Jews, "as under the law, that I might gain them that are under the law." But now it comes in verse 21, it says, "To them that are without law," those are the Gentiles, "as without law, be not without law to God, but under the law to Christ, that I might gain them that are without law." And then in verse 22, he affirms, "To the weak became I as weak, that I might gain the weak. I am made all things to all men, that I might by all means," look at this, "I might by every method, I might in every way possible, I might using every tool, that I might by all means save some." That was his concern. That ought to be your concern. Chapter number four, we're looking at his consecration with selfless surrender. Consecration with absolute surrender. Consecration with total surrender. Consecration with complete surrender. Every jot, every tittle of everything, every skill in his life, he gave to the Lord so that he will carry out this commission the Lord had called him to. Number four is consecration with selfless surrender. It tells us in Philippians chapter 3, reading there from verse 7. In Philippians chapter 3, reading there from verse 7, "But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ." He said, "For Christ, because of his gospel, for Christ, because of his service, for Christ, because of his kingdom, for Christ, because of his calling upon my life, every other sin, any other sin, all things in my life, what things were gained to me that I could profit from, those I counted for loss, counted loss for Christ." In verse 8, it says, "Yea, doubtless, I count all things, everything, but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered already the loss of all things, and even now I do count them but dung, that I may win Christ." In verse 9, then it says, "And be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith." And he had not stopped. He was still pursuing. Look at verse 14. In verse 14, it says, "I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." He had that pressing spirit. He wanted to accomplish all that the Lord has told him, has called him to accomplish, just to preach the gospel. It says in Romans chapter 1, reading from verse 14, Romans chapter 1, reading from verse 14, "I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise." And then in verse 15, it says, "So as much as in me is," that is, as long as still I have some strength, as long as my life still is existing here on earth, "as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also." But why? It says in verse 16, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and then also to the Greek. Number five now, it tells us about his commitment despite severe suffering. That man suffered, that minister suffered, that apostle suffered like no other apostle, like no other person in his generation. Nobody suffered for any cause, for any reason at all, like Paul the apostle suffered for the gospel. And yet he remained committed despite severe suffering. And that's what the Lord is calling you to, my brother, my sister, that we hold the gospel, we believe the gospel, we spread the gospel, we preach the gospel, we take the gospel everywhere. Even if it means we suffer persecution, we suffer rejection, we suffer misunderstanding, like Paul the apostle, we remain committed to the preaching, propagation, and the spread of the gospel, getting people saved and getting them to know the Lord in spite of or despite severe suffering. It tells us in Acts chapter 26, reading from verse 19. Acts chapter 26, verse 19, it said, whereupon, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision. He got the vision from heaven. He got the calling from heaven. And he got that pursuit of his life from heaven. And he said, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient unto that heavenly vision. He said, but I showed forth unto them of Damascus and at Jerusalem and throughout all the coasts of Judea. Look at that. In Jerusalem, what the Lord had given the whole church to do, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. You receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You'll be a witness unto. You'll be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and then to the uttermost part of the earth. This Paul the apostle carried the torch of the gospel. And he said unto them first at Damascus where the gospel found me, and then at Jerusalem, and then throughout all the coasts of Judea and to the uttermost part of the earth now, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and do works meet for repentance. It tells us about how he did it, verse 21. For these causes, the Jews caught me in the temple and went about to kill me. And yet he continued. Look at verse 22. In verse 22, we're looking at his continuity with single-minded steadfastness. Continuity with single-minded steadfastness. It tells us, having therefore obtained help of God, I continue unto this day, having then obtained help of God in Damascus, in Jerusalem, and even to the Gentiles, and even at Corinth, everywhere, having obtained help that sustained him, having obtained help that strengthened him, having obtained help of God, I continue unto this day, witnessing both to small and great, saying none other things than those which the prophets and Moses did say should come. In verse 23, that Christ, here is the gospel, here is what he emphasized everywhere, here is what he proclaimed everywhere, here is what we're to proclaim. And we're not to allow circumstances or pandemic or anything to change the message of the gospel. Here is what he did everywhere, every time, having obtained help of God. Here is what he continued to say and continued to preach, that Christ should suffer and that he should be the force that should rise from the dead and should show light unto the people and to the Gentiles. And then we'll see his companions in sacrificial servitude. We're coming back to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We're looking at verse 1. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 1, Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God and Sosthenes our brother. He had companions, and all these companions, they were addicted to the preaching of the gospel. They were addicted to serving the saints, edifying the church, and evangelizing the world, all of them without exception. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 16, reading from verse 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 15, it says, I beseech you, brethren, ye know the house, the household of Stephanas, that it is the first fruit of Achaia, and that they have addicted themselves to the ministry of the saints. That's a companion of Paul the apostle, addicting themselves. You understand the word addicted? When you are so given to something, you cannot shake yourself out of it. They addicted themselves to the ministry of the saints. He had many other companions too, and all those companions had the same goal, the same vision, the same pursuit, the same passion, the same commitment, the same consecration. And remember, all this had been written for our learning, so that we too, at this end of the age and at this end of time, will pursue it just like them. It should be true about you, about me, about every one of us. Number one, our conversion by the seeking Savior. There must be definite assurance and witness of the Spirit of God that we are born again. Number two, our call to soul saving service, that anything we do in the office, in the market, at home, anything we do will be to help people and lead people to salvation. Number three, we should have concern for the sinner's salvation, the sinners that we see everywhere, the sinners that we think about, that we talk about, the sinners, everyone that has not received the Lord Jesus Christ. We should have concern, a consuming concern, a consuming passion for the sinner's salvation. And we should have consecration with selfless surrender. We surrender everything. We don't only sing it, that I surrender all to Jesus, my Savior, my Lord. I surrender all. Make it practical, make it visible, make it tangible, that people will see we have the consecration with selfless surrender, and then we have commitment despite severe suffering. In fact, none of us can have the suffering that Paul the apostle went through. Whatever the persecution and whatever the slight little things, a light affliction that we're going through today, we still remain committed in spite of the severe suffering, and then we continue. There's no point you started something you cannot continue. You must not be an unfinished project. The ministry in your hand must not be an unfinished project, and your decision to serve the Lord, that decision should not be an unfinished project. The continuity you have was single-minded steadfastness, and then you have companions, you have friends that rally around, and they're doing the same thing. They are committed to the same thing that you are committed to, which is the preaching of the gospel. Let's come to point number two now. In point number two, we're reading from 1 Corinthians, and we're looking at chapter 1, reading from verse 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, we're reading from verse 2. It says, unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours. Then it says in verse 3, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Then he goes on to say, I thank my God always on your behalf, Corinthians. I thank my God always unto you who are called into salvation, and you have accepted that salvation, for the grace of God, which is given you by Jesus Christ. And then he says in verse 5, that in every place ye are in everything, ye are enriched by him in all utterance and in all knowledge. It tells us in verse 6, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you. Here he's talking about the congregation of the children of God at Corinth. And he's talking about the confirmation of their conversion, the confirmation of their salvation, the testimony of the Spirit of God that even Paul the Apostle too could bear witness to, that they were real children of God. The congregation and the confirmation of converted souls. We're looking at three things here. Number one, the church called out from sin. The church called out from sin. Look at that verse 2, the begin there. Unto the church of God. Unto the church of God. That church in the original language is ecclesia. Ecclesia, that just means in a normal language, called out people, called out of a called out assembly. They were called, number one, out of darkness, and they were called into the light. They were called, number two, out of their sin, and they were called to the Savior. Number three, they were called out of the world, and they were called unto the Lord. The church is a called out people, called out of sin, called out of iniquity, called out of their bad habits, called out of their idolatry, called out of all the corruption of Corinth, the church called out from sin. And let's look at Acts chapter 15, reading from verse 14, and you see the plan of God, the purpose of God, called out from sin. Acts chapter 15, verse 14, Simon has declared how God at the first did visit the Gentiles. Why did he visit the house of Cornelius and those Gentiles? Look at this. To take out of them a people for his name. Called out. That's the church. When you are called out of your sin, and when you are converted, when you are born again, a new life now has come, and you have responded to the commandment of the Lord, come out from among them. And now you believe on the Lord, you're part of the called out assembly, part of the called out people, part of the church of the living God. And let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 6, reading from verse 17. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17. Here is the Lord talking to everyone. He says, wherefore come out from among them, come out from sin, come out from crime, come out from the criminals, come out from the gang, come out from occultism, come out from corruption, come out from the degrading things that you know the people of the world do. Come out from that world, come out from among them, and be ye separate, says the Lord. That's how the church is formed. That's how the church comes in place. The Lord says, be ye separate and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. And then in verse 18, it says, and I will be a father unto you. It's not a father to, you know, the general population of people. It's not a father to the whole, you know, all the people, humanity on earth. But the people who have come out of their sin and they have embraced the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. And they have believed on the Lord and their lives are transformed. And now they are not of the world, even as Christ was not of the world. And God says, when you come out like that, I will be a father unto you. And ye shall be my sons and my daughters, says the Lord Almighty. That's the church called out from sin. Number two, let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, and we're looking at verse 2. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 2, Christians called to be saved. Christians are called to be saved. Number one, we're called out of sin. And then we're not just living in a vacuum. I'm called out, but I'm in no man's land. You come to the light and you come to the righteousness of the Lord. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 2, unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified, to them that are set apart, to them that are called to be only for the Lord in Christ. In Christ Jesus, called to be saints. You see that? called to be saints. That's a calling. That's the calling of everyone that says, I'm born again. That's the calling of everyone that says, I belong to the Lord now. I am now set apart unto the Lord Jesus Christ. I am called to be a saint with all them that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, both theirs and ours. In Romans chapter 1, verse 7. Romans chapter 1, reading from verse 7. Here is the calling. Every church, whether it's at Rome, or at Corinth, or Ephesus, or Philippi, or Colossae, or here in our nation, everyone that is called of God into salvation is called to be saints. In Romans chapter 1, verse 7, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints. You see that? That's the understanding you ought to have about yourself. You're called out of your past. You're called out of darkness. You're called out of the Gentile lifestyle. You're called out of the worldly lifestyle. And you're called out of sin. You become part of the ecclesia. You become part of the church. And you're called to be saints. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at Ephesians chapter 5, we're reading from verse 1. Ephesians chapter 5, reading here from verse 1. It says, be ye therefore followers of God. You are called out already. Here is the purpose, you are a Christian. Here is the purpose, you are a new creature. It says, be ye therefore followers of God as dear children. Look at verse 2. It says, and walk in love as Christ also has loved us. We're no more walking in the hatred of the sinners. We're no more walking in the malice of the sinners. We're no more walking in the attitude, in the temper, in the disposition of the sinners that have not had their nature changed, but now we're children of God. And the nature of Christ, the very Son of God, is now imparted into us. And he said, because of that, we have called out of the world. We were being called out of the world. We are not part of them. We are not living like them. God is love, and Christ is love. And walk in love, as Christ also has loved us, and has given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. In verse 3 now, remember, we are called to be saints. Remember, you are called to be a saint. It says, but fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be once named among you, look at this, as becometh saints, as it befits saints, because that's our calling, that's the life we now live. It tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1, 1 Peter chapter 1, reading from verse 15, because we're called to be saints, look at the life we live. But as he which has called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. He called us, and because he called us to be holy, so that we can be saints, we are now saints in Christ. He says, be ye holy, for I am holy. We're now chosen. Look at number 3 here. The chosen, cleansed, confirmed, and sanctified. We're looking at it now. Look at verse 2 again in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 2. It says, unto the church which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus. And there are many people who do not understand this kind of a verse or sentence, because when you go into the book, into the epistle to the Corinthians, you'll see some individuals that were not actually living right. But you see, there were people that were living right. When Paul the Apostle said, it has been declared unto me of you, brethren, by the house of Chloe. That house of Chloe, they distinguished themselves from the rest of the people. And then when he said, there is fornication among you, such fornication as had not been named even among the Gentiles. That one is not talking about all of them. One person committed that sin, they didn't deal with of that. And so it's not that, you know, all the Corinthian church, all the members were sinful, were profligates, were prodigals, were corrupters. Not like that. There were those who were sanctified. And now Paul the apostle addressed himself to them, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saved. That's a general calling. That's a calling for everyone. If anybody backslides, he should repent immediately and remember our calling, that we're called to be saved with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours. It tells us in verse 5, it says that in every sin ye are enriched by him in all utterance and in all knowledge. And then in verse 6, it says, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, here we're told that these ones were chosen. They were cleansed. They were sanctified. They were confirmed. Look at their choice in verse 27. In verse 27, it says, but God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things that are mighty. Very clearly, it tells us then that these Corinthian believers, actually, those who have given their lives to the Lord and those who remain of the Lord, sanctified, cleansed, confirmed, chosen, and that's for everyone too. The Lord has chosen us, but he has chosen us for a purpose. He has called us for a purpose. He has cleansed us for a purpose. It tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 11, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 11, look at this, and such were some of you. He has spoken in verses 9 and 10 about those who will not inherit the kingdom of God because of sin, because of fornication, because of adultery, because of idolatry, and because of all those things. He said, of the which I tell you, and I'm still telling you, that those people shall not inherit the kingdom of God. And he didn't say all of you, that is how you are. No, he said, and such were some of you. And such were some of you. And even some of those people were like that. They are now washed, and they are now sanctified, and they are now justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of God. We understand then these Corinthian believers, like us now, were washed. Like us now, we're cleansed. Like us now, we're sanctified. Like us now, we're devoted unto the Lord. And we remember our calling, that we're called to be saints. The Lord has called us to be saints. And we need to abide in that calling that the Lord himself has called us. It tells us in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4, it says, according as he has chosen us, he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. Look at the purpose of that choice. It says that we should be holy. That's the purpose of the choice. That's why he has chosen us. According as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. In Ephesians chapter 5, reading from verse 25. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. And then in verse 26, this is the reason why he has called us, that he might sanctify and cleanse it. Fulfill the purpose of your calling. Fulfill the purpose of you being chosen, that he might sanctify and cleanse it, that's the church, or the washing of water by the word. The word should be cleansing us every time, and purging us every time, and preparing us every time, and making us make progress in holiness and righteousness and saintliness every time. In verse 27 of Ephesians chapter 5, it says that he might present ye to himself a glorious church, called out glorious, called out of sin, glorious. Called out of the degradation and of the corruption of the world, glorious. Not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. It tells us in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, he has chosen us, he has cleansed us, he has confirmed us and sanctified us for a purpose. He says, but ye are at this present time now, not what you were in the past, what you are today, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood and holy nation, a peculiar people, that he should show forth, here is our calling, that he should show forth, here is our consecration, that he should show forth, here is our commitment, that he should show forth, here is what we continue in, that he should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness. That's the church, called out, call you out of darkness into his marvelous light. We come now to point number three. In point number three, we're looking at how the gifts of the Spirit and how that the charismata was confirmed and conferred upon the Corinthian believers, the conferment of charismata or charismata on consecrated saints. We're coming to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We're reading from verse 7. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 7, so that ye come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Comparing the Corinthian church with other churches, the churches of Galatia and the church at Ephesus and the church at Philippi and all the other churches, he said, ye come behind in no gift, that you take your place and you receive everything the Lord has conferred upon you, that ye come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. It tells us in verse 8, it says, who shall confirm you unto the end? He has confirmed you already. He has conferred the grace of God. He has conferred the gifts of God. He has conferred the goodness of God upon you. But not only that, he did that in the past when you were called, when you were chosen, when you were cleansed, when you were sanctified. He will continue. He will confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless. Look at the purpose of God. We cannot give any excuse. Somebody committed this in the church at Corinth. Somebody did this other thing in the church at Corinth. That's not the plan of God. That's not the purpose of God. The purpose of God is that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. And then in verse 9, it talks about the faithfulness of God. God is faithful, by whom ye were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. As we look at the Corinthian church, and we look at our church too, and we see the plan of God and the purpose of God, look at what God wants to accomplish. Number one, sons endowed with grace. Sons endowed with grace. And that's what we should be. We should have the grace of God in our lives, the grace that brings salvation, that has appeared unto all men and teaching us to deny ungodliness and worldly lusts. We should live soberly and righteously and godly in this present world because we are sons and daughters of God endued with grace. That's why it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, it says, grace be unto you and peace from God. Remember, grace is not just saying it. You know, that's what we always say, grace be unto you and peace. No, it's for a purpose. The grace that brings salvation, the grace that brings righteousness, and the grace that leads us into the character of God, into the nature of God, into the life of Christ, into the lifestyle of the Lord that has called us. It says that grace will be outpoured upon us. Grace be unto you I'm from God, a Father. I'm from the Lord Jesus Christ. In verse 4, it says, thanks, I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God which is given you by Jesus Christ. It's saying, I didn't just say grace superficially. I see that grace of God in you. I can identify that grace of God in you. If they were all backsliding, if every member was committing fornication, if every member had gone astray, if nobody was fit for the kingdom of God now, if everyone was a backslider, everyone was a sinner in the Corinthian church, how can you say, I thank my God on your behalf? No, it's only a few people that did that. The majority of them, Paul the apostle said, you're endowed with the grace of God. And I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God which is given unto you by Jesus Christ. And let's look at number 2, servants enriched with gifts. We're coming to 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 5. It says they were serving the Lord, but they were enriched with the gifts of God. That in everything ye enriched by him, in everything ye enriched by him, in all utterance and in all knowledge. Let the Lord be able to say that concerning us. Let the apostle be able to say that concerning you and I. Let the pastors be able to say that about the members. That we thank God, we bless the Lord that in everything that our members, the children of God are enriched by him, enriched with the gifts of God. And then he goes on to say, in all utterance and in all knowledge, that as we're studying and as we're learning, we're retaining that knowledge, and the minister and the pastor and the overseer can rejoice because of us, saying, we thank the Lord, we're enriched by him in all utterance and in all knowledge. It tells us in 2 Corinthians, reading from chapter 9, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, looking at verse 8, it talks about the fact that God is able to make all grace abound toward you. God is able to make all grace abound towards me, the grace to serve, and the grace to perform, and the grace to do, and the grace to accomplish everything the Lord has called upon you, upon me, upon us to accomplish. God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye, look at this, always having all sufficiency in all things, that grace available to make us have all sufficiency in all things, they abound to every good work. And then in verse 11, it says in verse 11, being enriched in every sin unto all bountifulness. We can be enriched like that, that no problem in our lives will drown us, will perplex us, will crush us, will be able to stand, will be enriched in everything to all bountifulness, which causes through us thanksgiving unto God. Number one, they were sons endowed with grace. Number two, they were servants enriched with gifts. Number three, they were saved, ensured by his goodness. They were saved and ensured by his goodness. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 6. It says, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you. The testimony of Christ confirmed in you. There was that assurance in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, we're looking at verse 12. It's talking about this same Corinthians in the second epistle that Paul the apostle wrote to them. For our rejoicing is this, we rejoice over you. You understand? If all of them were down, if all of them were in the mud, if all of them were in the dust, it could not have been saying our rejoicing is this, but he rejoiced over them. He said, our rejoicing is this, for the testimony of our conscience, that in simplicity and godly sincerity, not with fleshly wisdom, But by the grace of God, that's the grace again, by the grace of God, we have had a conversation in the world and more abundantly to you, word. That should be a testimony to you. Look at number four, seekers endued with gifts. Seekers endued with gifts. You see, the Corinthian believers, they knew the gifts of God, they knew they were available. And because of that, they were seeking. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 7, it says, so that ye come behind in no gift. It was talking about the gifts of the Spirit. It says, I compare you with all the other churches, and ye come behind in no gift. And then it talks about the experiences in the Lord. You are washed, the others are washed too. You are cleansed, the others are cleansed too. You are commissioned, the others are commissioned too. You are endowed with gifts and endued with gifts, and the others are endued too. And you are not taking the back seat, you are at the very forefront. Ye come behind in no gift at all. When he talks about the gifts of God, he's talking about the fulfillment of the promise of the Spirit of God upon them. Look at this in Luke chapter 24, reading from verse 49. Luke chapter 24, reading from verse 49. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. That's the gift of the Spirit. And the Corinthian believers, there were those who seriously sought the Lord, and they waited upon the Lord until they were endued with the gift of the Spirit of God. In Acts chapter 2, reading from verse 38, Acts chapter 2, reading from verse 38, and then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins. Look at this. And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. That's what the Corinthians did. They were saved. They were converted. They were born again. They were washed. That's what the Corinthians did after they were cleansed, after they were purged, after they were purified, after they were sanctified. They waited on the Lord. Tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem. Tarry ye over there in Corinth. Tarry ye over there in the city where you are, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. In verse 39, it says, for the promise is unto you, and to your children, and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. The promise is unto you. When Peter was speaking, he was speaking to those Jews in Jerusalem. The promise is unto you. When Peter was speaking, he was speaking to those that came from all those various countries and nations, and they came to Jerusalem. In many nations they have come. He said, the promise is unto you. And then he said, it's to your children as well as to your converts. And then he says, and to all that are far off in Gentile lands, and at Corinth, and at Ephesus, and at Philippi, and to Africa, and everywhere in the Gentile world, the Lord has called us. He says, to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And these ones that were servants, these ones that were seekers of the Lord and of the gifts of the Lord, they sought and they were helped. They sought and they received the gift of the Holy Ghost. If you will seek like that today, it will endure you too. You make sure you are saved, and you make sure you are sanctified, and the Adamic nature has been dealt with, and the Lord has purified and purged you, and you are absolutely and totally, entirely submissive, surrendered unto the Lord. I want to remind you that you too, you can so get up and you can so receive and abound in the gifts of the Spirit that will be able to testify concerning you that ye come behind in no gift at all. Look at that verse 7 again. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 7. It says, so that ye come behind in no gift. Look at this now, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. They knew the Lord would be coming again. Number 5, saints expecting him from glory. saints expecting the Lord Jesus, that he will come in glory and come with glory. It tells us they were waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The same thing you'll find of all other believers in the New Testament. For example, 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 verse 10. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, reading from verse 10, it says, and to wait for his son from heaven. The Corinthians were waiting for his son from heaven, and these Thessalonians were waiting for his coming from heaven. And the believers of today too, you are saved, you are sanctified, you are filled with the Holy Ghost, you are serving the Lord, you are evangelizing, you are doing everything you can do to touch the lives of sinners, and you are doing all that while you are waiting for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us. He's done that in the past. He has delivered us from the wrath to come. Now we're waiting for his son from glory. Look at Colossians chapter 3, verse 4. The Lord is coming. Colossians chapter 3, verse 4. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, is coming again, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. These Corinthian believers, they were sanctified and they were established in godliness. Sanctified and established in godliness. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8. Who shall also confirm you unto the end? Who shall also confirm you unto the end? The apostle was positive about them. He had no shadow of doubt in his heart that the Lord who has begun a good work in them will continue and accomplish it to the very end. Who shall also confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless, that ye may be spotless, that ye may be without wrinkle. In short, that ye may abide and remain sanctified without spot, without wrinkle or any such thing, but that ye should be holy and without blame, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's the purpose of God, and that's the plan of God for us, that we're saved, that were sanctified, that were established in godliness. In 2 Peter chapter 1, he has given us his nature. 2 Peter chapter 1, looking at verse 3, he gave us his nature so that that godliness will be reproduced in us. It says, according as his divine power has given unto us all things, he has not withheld anything we need to be overcomers, anything we need to be victorious, anything we need to be triumphant, everything we need to be holy and righteous and without blame, blameless and spotless, according as his divine power, he has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. He has given unto us. We can receive. If he has given, we need to believe, we need to embrace, and we need to personalize it and take it in according as his divine power. He has given unto us, unto you and unto me, unto all the believers that will believe and receive. He has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that has called us, that's our calling again. He has called us to glory and virtue. Look at verse 4. In verse 4 it says, whereby are given unto us. We have no reason to backslide. Whereby he has given unto us. We have no reason to be weak. Whereby he has given unto us. We have no reason to complain. Is this insurmountable problem? Is this besetting sin? Is this corruption? No excuse at all, because whereby he has given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. Look at this. That by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature. Think about that. Partakers of the divine nature. The divine nature is not in darkness. The divine nature is not weak. The divine nature is not falling into sin every now and then. The divine nature is not into the bad habits of the past. The divine nature is not overcome, overwhelmed by all the attacks and all the afflictions, all the temptations of the devil. It says that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. That's what he was giving us. And as we're expecting the coming of the Lord, we need to remain in that state of sanctification, in that state of establishment in godliness. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 11, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 11, seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness? That's the kind of man, the kind of woman, the kind of believer we ought to be in all holy conversation and godliness. In verse 12, looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. And then in verse 13, it says in verse 13, nevertheless we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. Look at the conclusion in verse 14. In verse 14, wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent that ye may be found in him, of him in peace, without spot and blameless. We're coming back to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, and we're reading from verse 9. Steadfast, enlisted by God. Steadfast and enlisted by God. It says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9, God is faithful. Our Creator is faithful. Our covenant keeper is faithful. The Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the one that so loved us and gave his only begotten Son that you and I might be saved. God is faithful, by whom ye were called unto the fellowship of his Son Jesus Christ our Lord. God is faithful in his love, in his mercy, in his goodness, in his calling. God is faithful in his plan, in his purpose, and the promise he has given us. God is faithful. And by that faithful God, we were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And now, because of that faithfulness, we know he has engaged us. He has enlisted us. He has enrolled us. We're now part of his family. He rejoices over us. And all we need for life and godliness, he has made available unto us. And we come to him thinking about his faithfulness. We come to him meditating on his faithfulness. We come to him expecting that he will do everything he has promised he will do on the basis of his faithfulness. He tells us in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23, and it says, let us hold fast the profession of our faith. Let us hold firm the profession of our faith. Let us hold steadfast the profession of our faith without wavering. Without wavering. Why? Why will you not shake? Why will you not waver? Why will you not doubt? Because he is faithful that promised. He is faithful that promised. And because of his faithfulness, he has called us into the fellowship of his dear Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we're holding fast. We know that nothing will happen that is not provided for, that solution will not come from the faithfulness of the Lord. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23, and the very God of peace, the God of peace, who has given you peace, deep peace, who has given you peace in justification, he has given you peace of salvation, he has given you peace with his grace, he has given you peace because you believe on the Lord, that very God of peace, sanctify you wholly, purify you wholly, purge you wholly, make you holy entirely, sanctify you wholly. And I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Look at verse 24. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. He has called you to salvation as you come. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. He will save. He has called you to sanctification. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. He has called you to receive power, the power of the Holy Ghost. Faithful is he who calleth you, who also will do it. He has given you the promise of healing, and he calls you to healing and health. And faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. He has called you to be an overcomer and to triumph in the Lord. And faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. He has called you into service, and to do that service creditably well, and to succeed in the service of the Lord. And faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. We're called out people. We're saints of God. The church is a called out people. And he said, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. He has called us one and all. He has called us as individuals. He has called us as families. He has called us as a whole church. And he will do what he has promised to do. We've learned today of who the children of God are. We're sons, we're servants, we're saved, we're seekers, we're saints of God, we're sanctified, and we're steadfast in the Lord. Every grace we need, every gift we need, all the goodness we need is available. He will do it in your life. There must be an addition in your life today, addition of grace, addition of the fulfillment of the purpose of God in your life. We're going to pray now and let God do something that you come behind in no grace, you come behind in no gift, you do not come behind in the calling of God upon your lives. He will do it. Let's rise up, brothers and sisters, and the Lord himself will multiply his goodness and grace upon your life. He called you for a purpose. He called me for a purpose. And that purpose for which he called us into his kingdom will be fulfilled. Stand up, brother. Stand up, sister. And then give yourself to the Lord. Everything we've learned today, everything we've heard today, the Lord called Paul the apostle. And the call was followed by consecration. The Lord has called you to, and that call should be followed with consecration, that you lay yourself upon the altar of the Lord. And like Paul the apostle, there'll be real conversion by the seeking Savior. He's called you, and then he's converted you, he's touched your life, and then that conversion is followed by a call. He called us to repentance. He called us to salvation. He called us to sanctification. He called us unto holiness. He called us unto his service. Tell the Lord, I receive the call, I accept the call, and I consecrate myself for the call. And then you have a concern. You have a concern. Number one concern in your life, that you will be what the Lord created you to be. That must be a great concern, that you will have all the grace available that the Lord has provided for you. That must be a great concern. And then that sinners around you will be called, will be touched, will be transformed by your ministry. And you consecrate yourself with selfless surrender. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. Make that surrender practical. Make that surrender definite. Days, I surrender. Time, I surrender. Skill, I surrender. Ability, I surrender. Everything I've got, I surrender. All my knowledge, I surrender for the service of the Lord. All my ability, I surrender. There must be a selfless surrender. That's consecration. And that consecration you renew every day. Your concern for sinners to be saved, you renew every day. And then you have commitment despite persecution, despite misunderstanding, despite, you know, you're feeling this and feeling that, despite anything that people call affliction or this or that, despite all that, you are committed unto the service of the Lord, and you continue. You continue. If you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed. If you continue in my work, then are you my disciples indeed. If you continue in my will, then are you my disciples indeed. If you continue in the service of the Lord, whatever you have started, as the Lord has called you, you continue, you continue. And Paul the Apostle said, I receive grace, the grace of God, and by him, by that grace and power, I continue until this day. Tell the Lord, there will be no day in your life when you look back. I continue, I continue, I continue. And then you have companions. You don't have companions that will pull you down. Don't have companions that will drag you back to the mud. You don't have companions that will make you backslide, but companions who have the same passion and the same vision and the same purpose and the same drive and the same consecration. Birds of the same feather, they fly together. And if you have companions that, you know, will empower you, will encourage you, will envision you, will fire you up, will make you fervent, then you'll be making progress. But if you have companions and friends that will drag you down, that will discourage you, that will say, well, is that not enough? Are you not giving too much to the Lord? You'll not be able to make progress. But like Paul the Apostle, he had companions that had the same mind and the same heart and the same spirit, companions in sacrificial servitude. And then you already, you know, you are part of the church. And part of the church, you are part of the congregation that is alive in Christ, congregation that is forging on and moving on, congregation, the church that knows we're called out from sin, called out from society. And you are not trying to be in agreement with sin and sinners, and with the societies of polluted people, or with any gang. You are not trying to please the people of the world. You are called out. Be part of the church. Part of the church. A militant church. A dynamic church. A fervent church. An outgoing church. Be part of the church that is kept away and separated from the things of this world, because we're called out from sin. Not only that, as Christians, we're called to be saints. Anything you want to do, can saints do that? Anything you want to say, will saints say that? Anywhere you want to go, will saints go there? Anything you are proposing or deciding, will saints propose that? Will saints accomplish that? Be a saint of God that has the nature of Christ, that has the nature of God, that is called to virtue and to godliness, a saint of God that has nothing to do with the defilement of the world. Always remember, anywhere you are, at home, outside the home, in church, outside the church, anywhere you are, in your place of work, at school, anywhere you are, in the marketplace, on the road, anywhere you are, the way you comport yourself, the way you direct your own life, you direct yourself as Christians, called to be saints. And you know you are chosen. Not only that you are chosen, you are cleansed. Not only that you are cleansed, you are confirmed. And you are sanctified. Let it be real, real sanctification, that you are cleansed and washed in the blood of the Lamb. And then we're told about the very fact that we have the conferment of the charismata, the conferment of the spiritual gifts upon us, because we are confirmed saints, we're consecrated saints. Let's be sons of God, daughters of God, endued with grace, endowed with grace, all grace available for all sufficiency. We cannot say, I don't have enough grace for that. We have enough grace for everything God brings our way. He endowed us with grace. He enriches our lives with gifts. I don't have this gift. I don't have this gift. Why not? Why not be like those Corinthian believers? Ye come behind in no gift at all. Go to the Lord. If you ask, he'll give you. If you seek, you'll find. If you knock, he'll open the door unto you. He gives good things and good gifts to all that ask him. And then he ensures our lives with his goodness. His goodness will overflow in your life. And then as seekers, we're endued with the gifts of the Spirit, the gift of power, the anointing, and the anointing, the power, the authority of the Holy Ghost. He gives unto us. We're saying that we're expecting the coming of the Lord. Don't allow any day to meet you not expecting the Lord. Don't ever say, I'm going to do this. The Lord may not come today. You'll be surprised. I'm going to go there. The Lord may not come today. You might be surprised. But let us be like the people. Let us be like the wise virgins who are waiting for their Lord, expecting the Lord from glory. Will remain sanctified, will remain established in godliness, and will remain steadfast, enlisted by God, enlisted, enrolled, engaged in the service of the Lord. Tell the Lord everything we've learned today, everything we've heard today, the Lord reproduce that in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for the revelation of your word. We thank you for this introduction. We thank you because of what you made of Paul the Apostle, and you're still the same. You have not changed. Lord Jesus, we accept you as our Lord. We declare you as our Lord. We lift you up as our Lord. We embrace you as our Lord. And everything you did in people, in servants of yours, stewards of yours, in days gone by, we know you are able to do, you are willing to do, you are even doing now in every one of our lives. Fill us with your grace. Increase your grace in our lives. Increase your love in our lives. Increase consecration, commitment, passion, purposeful pursuit in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. As we have been called out of sin, called out of the world, oh Lord, we pray like you are not of the world. We remain not to be of the world, but we remain in the kingdom of God, in the kingdom of your righteousness, in Jesus' name. We realize we're called to be saints, and we pray, oh Lord, that that saintliness and godliness and holiness will enrich our lives more and more, saturate our lives more and more, in Jesus' name. And we pray, Lord, we remain washed and cleansed and chosen, and we remain devoted unto you every moment of our lives unto the very end, in Jesus' name. And everything you have promised to do, we pray, Lord, as we trust in your faithfulness. Faithfulness to your covenant, faithfulness to your promises, and faithfulness to the provision you have provided on the cross of Calvary. We pray, Lord, we will receive everything in Jesus' name. Lord, turn our weakness to strength, and turn our ignorance to your knowledge. We pray, Lord, you enlighten us, and you make us established in all the provision of Calvary in Jesus' name. Saved, sanctified, spirit-filled, saturated, sons and daughters of God, will remain on fire for you, moving on and continuing in all the grace you have made available to every life. Lord, we pray that every day we'll be making progress, will not retrogress, will not backslide, will not fall down, will not be weakened, will be strengthened day by day, moving from strength to strength, from faith to faith, from grace to grace, and from glory to glory every day of our lives in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Thank you, and God bless you. Amen.